Friday. On Friday, you did your exploration activity, so hopefully you kind of got an idea of what's going on. Just some things to recap, okay? We were messing around with different values, right? We had certain things like moved it up and down, right? How did we move a function up and down? Do you remember? Adding, subtracting something, like to the end of the function, right? Good. What other changes did we have? Becca?
Well, you could change like how tall it was, like what the slope was.
Okay, so you could like, it was called stretching it,
yeah,
right?
That.
We could stretch it, we could compress it. Good. How did we do that?
Remember?
Change the slope. Change the slope, right?
Yeah.
The very like first value that you saw in front of your x's.
Cool.
Okay, other things? Moved up, down, stretched.
You could switch it across the x or y.
What's that called when you're switching?
The reflecting.
Reflecting. We were reflecting. Good. Wyatt?
You can move it left and right by adding a number like right after the x value, but not at the end.
Good. Okay, so a change to the end moves up and down. But if we change it like right in by the x, we can move left and right. Was there something tricky about that though? Philip?
Let's move to the right, you have a 90.
Yeah. So moving to the right was subtracting values, moving to the left was adding values, right? Which is kind of counterintuitive. But if you think back to like circles, when we were doing circles, if we had like our parentheses with our x and the squared on it, if we had x plus 4, that was actually a negative 4 when we looked at the center of our circle. And an x minus 4 was actually a positive 4 when we looked at the center of our circle, right? It's that same idea, okay? It's because there's a negative, like kind of built into the changes that are happening. I'm gonna show you that in 1 second, okay? So today we're gonna be looking at transformations of functions. Not even plugged in. We're gonna be looking at those changes, the up, down, left, right, stretch, compress, reflect, all of that stuff, okay? We're gonna be looking at them individually. We're also gonna be looking at them kind of all combined into one. Okay, so let's go through this first. Please write this down on your paper. This is a function that is having like a lot of different transformations happen to it. Okay, the A, the B, the C, the D, those represent different changes happening to our function. So we're going to talk about what each one of them means. Okay, think back to what you did Friday. A, what do you think that does to your function? Kind of like that idea of slope that you're thinking. It's not slope, okay, but it does have to do with the steepness of the line, right? So if it's linear, it kind of would be slope. But it's going to stretch or compress what you've got. This also results in some reflections if there is a negative there. Okay, so a negative out front would be a reflection over the x-axis. If that number is greater than 1, it's a vertical stretch. So like 2, 3, 5. It's going to stretch it. If that number is between 0 and 1, some fraction, some decimal, 1/2, 1/3, 0.75, something like that, it's going to compress it. Okay? So you need to know that A value is changing the stretch or the compression of the function. If it's a number larger than 1, it's stretching it. If it's a number that's less than 1, it's compressing it. Yes,
Charlotte. Does the same thing apply to like negative 1?
Yeah, so negative 1, let's say negative 2. How about that? So negative 2 is going to be a reflection and a stretch. So the 2 is telling us we're stretching, the negative is telling us we're reflecting. Okay?
-0.5,
exactly. The negative reflects it, the 0.5 compresses it. Okay, questions on A? Okay. B. B is also changing, the negative is going to be a reflection over the y-axis. Okay, so if you've got a negative there, it's different from a negative in front. Okay, it's gonna be a negative contained right by your x's. That's going to be a reflection over the y-axis. If value is greater than 1, it's a horizontal compression. And if the b value is between 0 and 1, it's a horizontal stretch. That's the opposite of what we just talked about, okay? For A, we said if it's bigger than 1, it's stretching it. And if it's smaller than 1, like 0.5, it's compressing it. Here, it's the opposite of that. Here, if I have a value that's greater than 1, it's actually compressing it. It's compressing it this way. And if it's less than 1, like 0.5, it's stretching it, okay? Counterintuitive. C, you guys talked about this one. This one was really easy for you guys to see. C and D are really easy for you guys to see, especially in that exploration. C is going to be a horizontal shift. It's moving left and right, okay? But as Philip mentioned to us before, if I have a positive value, I'm actually moving left. And if I have a negative value, I'm actually moving right. Counterintuitive, okay? That's because, bless you, the formula itself, this thing that I'm giving you here, it has negative. So if I plug in a positive 2 as C, it appears negative, right? That's why when I see negative 2, I'm actually going right, because it's a positive 2 that got plugged in, okay? So positive is left, negative is right. And then D, that's our vertical shift up and down. This is exactly as you would think. If it's a plus 3, you move up 3. If it's a minus 4, you move down 4, okay? So D is vertical shift, positive up, negative down. That's everything, okay? Those are all the transformations we can see. We can see them independently. We might see 2 of them, we might see 3 of them, we might see 5 of them. Just kind of depends on the function. Will you see functions on your test that have like 5 transformations? Sure, it'll happen, okay? So we're gonna take a look at how to work with them. Now, something that's very important that I didn't really talk about yet is all this stuff that I have in parentheses, x versus y. It's very important that you understand that the a value is going to affect your y values of your function. Your b affects your x values of your function. C also affects your x values. And D affects your y values. Okay, we're going to need to know that because we're going to be creating tables of values for our transformed functions using that idea. Okay, so basically anything that's contained right in here by the x, those changes are affecting our x values. Okay, and then the thing out front, the thing out back, those are affecting the y values. The other thing to kind of keep in mind, anything that's affecting the x values is counterintuitive, right? This is affecting x. It was counterintuitive. Positive means left, negative means right. This is also affecting x. It's counterintuitive. A large number means a compression, and a number that's small, like a 0.5 or 0.75, means a stretch. Okay, so kind of keep those things in mind. Questions so far? I know it's a lot of information. Okay. Okay. This slide is kind of sloppy. I apologize. I'm not sure why stuff got shifted around. But let's just look at a couple of things. Look right there at g of x. It's x squared plus 3. Okay, so think in your head. X squared plus 3. What general shape does it have? A parabola. Good. What transformation is happening? It's going up. Great. Right? So I know that the general shape of a parabola is going to be that, right? But now my function is being shifted up by 3. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3. So it looks very, very similar to what I drew in green. It's just moved up. Okay? That's my up 3. How about this one here? I guess I should have done whatever. What's happening there? X minus 3, that quantity squared.
Left 3.
Left 3, you say. you're right that it's left and right, but it's counterintuitive. It's actually moving to the right by 3. Okay? It's going right by 3 units. Okay, so over here, 1, 2, 3, would look something like that. Okay, those are just sketches. We will be doing some actual graphing. For right now, just sketches. Okay, so the plus 3 at the end, this changed our y's. It shifted everything up 3. And then here, see how this change happened right in with the x? It's right there. It's contained within the function itself. It's within the thing that's being squared. That results in a horizontal shift left-right. In this case, negative 3 means right 3. Okay. Change. So that's a change in x's. Okay. So then what do you think would happen? This is, again, kind of sloppy. We've got x to the 4th minus 1. We've got x minus 1 to the 4th, and we've got x plus 3 to the 4th plus 1. Those are 3 examples. I want you to write them down. I want you to see if you can figure out what transformations are happening. So give me a descriptor. Up, down, left, right, stretch, compress, reflect. What's happening? X to the 4th minus 1, x minus 1 quantity to the 4th, and x plus 3 quantity to the 4th plus 1. Bless you. So take a look at this for just a second. I'm gonna grab water. What do we think? First one.
It's going down.
Down. How many?
One.
Down one. Good. Change to y is happening out here at the very end. Down one. Next one, what happens here?
I'm going to the right one.
To the right by one. Good. Right. One. Change happening to the x's. And then here, I see 2 values. I see a 3, I see a 1. Raise your hand if you can tell me what happens to the 3. Why isn't the 3 there? Yeah, Marissa?
Moves left 3.
Good, left 3. So this is left 3. And then there's also 1. Who can help me with that one? Adam?
Goes up 1.
Up 1. Very good. Beautiful. Okay, so we kind of see the difference between a horizontal shift left right and a vertical shift up down. Good? Okay. Okay, so reflections. I don't really like this slide. Let's see. Let me just do some examples. Kind of ignore what's on this slide. We're going to talk about, like, this here. That is going to be a reflection over the x-axis. Okay, so if you've got the negative out front, it's reflection over the x-axis. We talked about that on the first slide. This might look like, let me give you this example because you'll understand this. G of x equals negative 3x squared plus x minus 5. Okay, so I totally made this up, but what's important is I see a negative here. Do you guys remember, hopefully, from looking at parabolas before, that a positive a value means a parabola going up? And a negative a value means a parabola going down. Do you remember that? Mm-hmm. Okay. Negative a value, parabola going down, aka a reflection. I've taken something look like this and I've reflected it over my x-axis. Okay, so this change out front of a function like this is going to be a reflection over the x-axis. We might also have changes that are happening inside of our function. For example, again, totally making this up, but let's see. Uh, let's pretend that this was the function that I gave you. This negative, it's contained within the squared, okay? It's right close to my x. This looks different from this. This, reflection over x-axis. This, reflection over y-axis. Okay, do you see the difference? All right, I'm gonna go quickly through this because I just looked at it 2 slides ago with you. But if I'm adding D and subtracting D, that's a shift up or down, okay, positive or negative. If I have a minus C or a plus C inside of my function, I'm moving left and right, counterintuitive, negative right, positive left, okay? And then we've got stretches and compressions. Stretches and compressions are going to pull my function high or squish my function in towards the axis. And that comes from this A value again, right? And the reason it has absolute value A here is kind of what Charlotte was asking. She said, does the negative though affect that? So like a negative 2, it's going to be a reflection, but then a stretch because the absolute value of 2 is going to be larger than 1. Okay, talked about that a little bit. That's the same idea. Let's do an example, okay? So in your notes, I want you to please create this table of values. This table of values is for some random function, okay? The function is defined by these points. I don't have like an actual equation that I can plug stuff into or that I can analyze the A's, the B's, the C's. This function is defined by these points, X and Y, okay? And then they're plotted here. I'd like you to create a graph in your notes as well. So you've got a table of values, and you've got your graph. We're going to do 3 changes to this. If you happen to have 3 different colors, it might be nice to do that. I'm going to use blue, green, there I'll use red, so we can kind of keep track of them. For each of these examples, we'll start with this one here. We are going to create a new table of values. Okay, that new table of values is going to be based on the changes that I see happening. Okay, in this particular function, I see 2 things. I see a negative here, and I see a minus 2 here. I have to know very well which things are affecting my x's and which things are affecting my y's. This negative out front, does it affect my x's or my y's? My y's. Yeah, think back to this slide. This is going to be super important here, okay? Y's, y's. X's, x's. My y's are on the outside, my x's are on the inside. So let's go back here. This is affecting my y. This is affecting my x. Instead of just having an x here, I'm going to place x plus 2 because really I need to be shifting to the right by 2. Okay, here's that counterintuitive aspect. This says minus 2, I write plus 2. Here, instead of writing y, I'm going to write negative y because I know that everything has to be reflected. Now, to create this new table of values, all I'm doing is I'm looking at my original table of values, and I am using these rules, okay? Original table of values, my first x is negative 2. My new rule is that I have to add 2. So negative 2 plus 2, 0. 0 plus 2, 2. 1 plus 2, 3. 3 plus 2, 5. These are my new x values. Now I create my new y values. I take my existing y values from my original table of values, and I'm going to make all of them negative because that's what I'm being told to do. I'm reflecting everything. So 4, negative 4. 3, negative 3. 0, 0. negative 1, positive 1. I now have a new table of values. That table of values has 4 points. Let's plot them. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, negative 4. 2, negative 3.
What did I just do?
Just kidding, I know how to plot points. 0, negative 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, negative 3, 1, 2, 3, 3, 0, and 5, 1. So I can see that I took this thing, I reflected it over my axis, and then I shifted it over 2 to the right. Questions on that example? We've still got 2 more. Okay, so I'm going to switch to blue and I'm going to do this one with you. Okay, I have my existing table values. I need to create a new one. Okay, I see 2 changes. I see a 2, I see a 3. This 3 I like. I know him. I know he affects my y's. I know he moves everything up 3. Y plus. Change to the x. Changes to the x's are counterintuitive. I see a 2, but I should be thinking 1/2. Okay? Because remember I told you that a number that's greater than x actually serves as a compression for my x's, and a number that's like a fraction actually serves as a stretch for my x's. So anything here, I'm going to take the reciprocal of it, okay? If this is a 2, I write a 2, 1/2. If this is a 4, I write a 1/4. A 3, a 1/3. If this is a 1/5, I write a 5. Okay, I'm writing the reciprocal of what I see. Those are my 2 changes. I've got them both. So now I take everything and I perform these rules to them. So 1/2, this can be negative 1. 0 stays, 1 becomes 1/2, 3 becomes 3/2. Then I take my y's, I'm going to add 3 to all of those numbers. So 4 becomes 7, 3 becomes 6, 0 becomes 3, and negative 1 becomes 2. I plot these, negative 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 7, 0, 6, 1/2, 3, and 3/2, 2. It's not perfect, but you get the idea. So you can see that this thing was squished together. Okay, it was made half as big. Mm-hmm. And it was shifted up a little bit. See it? Okay, last one. So there's something super important that this last example shows you. I'll tell you, this is something that's like super commonly missed, okay? Don't fall for the trap. Anytime you're dealing with this stuff in here, you need to make sure, let's go back real quick. See how this b is factored out of this? It's not bx minus c, right? It's the quantity b times x minus c. If you're given something that doesn't look like that, you need to make it look like that before you can start. Okay? So let's go back to our example and I'll show you what I mean. Here, I have negative x plus 1. I need to take that negative, I need to factor it out to the front so that it's b times quantity x minus c. So this I need to rewrite as y equals f of negative the quantity x minus 1. All I'm doing is I'm taking out that negative to the front, but when I do that, it changes the sign too because I'm taking out a factor. Okay, you with me there? Okay, this has to happen. I have to have it in this form. Because now I can see that I've got a B value that's negative. But here, I see that I've got a change. I'm shifting to the right by one. Okay? So let's create our new table of values. Changes happening to the X, I'm reflecting. And I'm adding one because it's counterintuitive to this. My y's are not changing at all. There's nothing happening before my function. There's nothing happening after my function. So y's are going to stay the exact same. Okay. Yeah.
So you had to change it. You had to factor out the negative one, but it still ends up the same thing.
You're right. So when you put it in here, it ends up the same. This is important. Like if I'm asking you, state my A, B, C values and tell me what happens. Tell me if I'm shifting to the left, to the right, whatever. Because if you're looking at this, you may say, oh, I see a plus one, so I'm shifting left. But that's not true, right? Because if you factor that out, you actually see you're shifting right. So you're right. If you don't factor this out, you get the correct thing in the table, but you will not get the correct idea of what's happening. Yeah, I'm glad you pointed that out. Okay, so my y values are staying the exact same. I lost them. 4, 3, 0, negative 1. 4, 3, 0, negative 1. My x values, though, I have to take negative x and then add 1. So here this was negative 2. It will become positive 2. And then when I add 1, I've got 3. Then I've got, okay, so 0 becomes negative 0. That's irrelevant. Plus 1 is 1. 1 becomes negative 1, plus 1 gives me 0. And 3 becomes negative 3, plus 1 gives me negative 2. So these would be my new points. I would plot them. I'm going to skip that for the sake of time. Okay. Questions? So that kind of gives you an idea of what we're doing. We start with our original table of values. We create a new table of values based on the changes we see to the function, based on the transformations that are happening. We kind of number crunch through, and we have our new points to plot. Okay. So personally, for each problem that I do, I make two tables of values. I'm going to show you exactly what I mean by doing some more examples. So here's a function. They're giving me a function that I need to transform. They're not giving me the original table of values. Okay, so it's going to require a little bit of thinking on your part to figure out where to start so you can even make the changes. So f of x equals 2 times absolute value of x plus 1. Absolute value of x. What does that look like? Bless you. Absolute value of x. General idea. Charlotte, what's it look like?
Like a
V, right? So my original function looks something like this. Okay, if you want to kind of just do a rough sketch on a graph so you can see it, that's fine with me. That's not going to be graded though. So like, I know it looks like this. Okay. Do I know some points that I can maybe plug in for x and y of absolute value of x? Like, I don't know. We could just do negative 2, negative 1. 0, 1, and 2, right? Those would be good points for this function. If I plug in a negative 2 to my absolute value, what do I get? You guys are really with it today. 2. If I plug in negative 1, I get 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 2, 2. So this is my original table of values. I had to create it. I had to create it based on a little bit of my knowledge of the absolute value function. So you do have to kind of know some of your functions and what points you should plug in. Well, I have some changes happening to this. So now I'm going to create a new table of values for this function. The changes that are happening, I see a 2, I see a 1. What is the 1 affect? My y, so that's easy. Okay, so I know I'm going to have a plus 1 here. Okay. What is the 2 affect? Is the 2 contained within the absolute value? No. Okay, so that means it's out front of my absolute value, my parent function. So it does also affect the y. So it's going to be 2y plus 1, and this is just x. There's no changes happening inside of here. If there were changes happening inside of the absolute value bars, that would be changes to my x. Okay, here everything's to my y. So I've got my original table of values. My x's are not changing. My y's are. The 2 becomes a 5. The 1 becomes a 3. 0 becomes 1. 1 becomes 3. 2 becomes 5. How does negative 2? Oh, that's a good question. It doesn't. Oh, this doesn't. This doesn't. It's this. These values, my original y values, get plugged into my y. Okay. Questions? Okay, let's plot them real fast. So, negative 2, 5. Negative 1, 3. 0, 1. 1, 3. 5, what are we doing? 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Visually, if I'm looking at this, I see that from my green to my red, I shifted up a little bit and I stretched because I got a lot skinnier, right? I pulled it up. If I look at the function, vertical stretch by a factor of 2, vertical shift by 1. Totally makes sense. Questions? Okay. So write this one down. I want you to think about the original table of values. What's my parent function here? My function, if I take away all of the pluses, minuses, all that change, what is this thing? Square root of x, exactly. So square root of x is my parent function. Okay, that's what I need to create my original table values from. Then we need to make our transformed table of values. That's gonna happen here. So you take a look at that for a second. Good question. Well, let's think about it. Okay, so square root of x. What are some numbers that I could plug into it? 1. Let's start with 0. Okay, if I plug in 0, I get 0. Okay, if I plug in 1, I get 1. What's another nice number to plug into the square root of x?
4.
If I plug in 4, I get
2.
Another one?
9
would give me 3. Okay, so let's graph it. Let's see what this looks like to even start with. 0, 0, 1, 1, 4, 2, and 9, 3. So my original function looks something like that. Now I'm making changes, though. Okay? Are we good with this? Our original function. So changes.
This is really ugly.
I see 3 changes. I see a negative out front. I see a minus 1 underneath my radical. And I see a plus 2 out at the very back. Okay. Plus 2, what does it affect? My y's. Yeah, that's a shift up too. We should be really good at recognizing those. This negative out front, what does it affect? My y's. This negative 1 inside, what does it affect? My x's. So here I'm going to have have negative y plus 2. What should I have here? X plus 1. Good. It's counterintuitive. You see minus 1, you think plus 1. Okay? So now I take all my x values and I add 1 to them. So 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 4 plus 1 is 5. 9 plus 1 is 10. Then I take all of my y's that I started with for my parent function. I'm going to make them all negative and then add 2. So 0 becomes 2. 1, negative 1 plus 2 is 1. 2, negative 2 plus 2 is 0. 3, negative 3 plus 2 is negative 1. So my new function is 1, 2, 2, 1, 5, 0, and 10, negative 1. Yeah, Charlotte.
What are those on arrows, like on the line?
So, with a square root function, could I continue this direction? I'd have negative x values. Can I do negative x values? No, so I'm not going to have an arrow there. But the function does continue forever in the other direction. I can plug in numbers as big as I want. Okay, and that kind of gets us thinking about domain and range. My domain and range, we talked about this in your functions exploration too, that's going to be changing, right, for some things. For parabolas, my domain is always all real numbers, so it doesn't matter. But my range is changing based on where I'm at in a vertical shift. Right here, for a square root function, I'm going to have everything this direction. Okay, I'm never going to get higher than 2. That's affecting my range. So I do have to think about these things. Okay, we've got a couple more minutes. Let's do a little bit of practice. The really critical things, I know you guys can plot points, right? What I want to know is whether you can identify what the original parent function is, and can you create the like header for what your new rules for your x and y would be. Okay, so I'll do the first one with you so I can kind of show you what I'm looking for. For this problem, I want you to say parent function. If I strip away all of my numbers there, I'm left with a square root of x. Right, so that's my parent function. So I'm thinking square root of x, I want to plug in 0, I want to plug in 1, I want to plug in 4, 9. Okay. Over here, though, I want you to identify what your new rules would be. So if I had to make a new x, y, my rule for my x's, it's just x. There's nothing really happening here. My rule for my y's, I've got this change, and I've got this change. So it'd be negative 2y plus 3. So I want you to take these four examples, and I want you to see if you can identify the original parent function, if you strip away all of your numbers, all of your transformations, and I want you to create your new rules for your transformed table of values. Okay, so I'm going to give you seriously, like 2 minutes to do that because we're almost out of time. See if you can knock that out real quick. I'll throw them up there. take a look at the board. I think hopefully we should be pretty good with this, recognizing what the parent functions are. Here's all of the transformations that would happen. Okay, I want to draw your attention to this last one. Here you have 3x plus 6 underneath a cubed root. Sorry, this should be cubed root. Slacker. Okay, I'm good. Thanks. Cubed root, I've got the 3x plus 6. I have to factor out this b value of 3. I have to rewrite this as 3 times the quantity x plus 2. Okay? This is kind of like what we were talking about before by taking out the negative. Now it's a 3. So I've got a 1/3 coming out in front of my x and a minus 2. Okay, it's not 1/3 and minus 6. That's going to mess it up. I need to make sure I factor this out. Change is happening. This 3 becomes a 1/3. The 2 is a negative 2. A negative and a plus 1 to my y. A 7 and a minus 2 to my y. Please check Schoology. Homework's going to be on Schoology. I'll see you tomorrow. Have a great day.